Hugh, it's amazing to have you here with us at Raindance. Why do you think that celebrations of independent storytelling are so special and important?
Well, I guess independent by definition means, you know, you get to run the show a bit more and don't have to answer to as many people. So hopefully you get a more singular vision and to hear from different voices.
Of course, you've been part of a wonderful vision in Fleabag. Can you talk a little bit about why you think it has been such a landmark series and it has connected with so many people?
Well, I think Phoebe Waller-Bridge is someone who is very true to her vision and, you know, singular idea, and also has the talent and skill to see it into something actual, as, you know, as opposed to a dream or...
How do you feel about the fact that the show, at least on screen, has drawn to a close now? Because I think fans would have had an appetite for many more series, but I believe that's it. We're done now after season two.
Well, apparently, yeah. I mean, I think she thought she was done after the first one and then just had a brainwave and went for the second one. I can't even remember the question. What did you ask?
Just, I guess, you know, how it feels about, you know, the fact that the show is over, and how did you feel about how season two wrapped up?
Yeah, I mean... Oh, I don't know what to say. Yeah, it's all done. It's sad, but I feel like the first one was complete, and then she sort of bettered it, I thought, with the second one, and that felt very complete as well. So, you know, who knows?
On an exciting front, I believe you've got a new period drama that you've been working on that we're going to be enjoying soon. Can you tell us a bit about that one?
Yeah, good knowledge, yeah. I've been doing a drama called Little Birds for Sky, based on Anais Nin's book of short stories Little Birds, which is set in Tangier in the 50s, and I think, but it'll be on Sky, I don't know when, but yeah.
You talk about your experiences making that, obviously an exotic setting and a wonderful cast alongside you, I believe, as well.
Yeah, we got to film in Spain, which is very nice, lots of tapas. Yeah, it was fantastic, lots of sex scenes, which was quite daunting, but you know, fantastic cast, so it was great.
I'm curious, with period drama, why do you think, particularly as a nation, we seem so drawn to our past and to exploring particularly some of these key points in our history?
Yeah, that's interesting. I have no idea. I mean, I think period drama is almost like sci-fi sometimes. It's like a total different set of rules, and you can't believe it was so recent, often. I mean, in this Little Birds, the character I'm playing is gay, and, you know, in the 50s, the rules around that stuff is gobsmacking, and you can't believe it was so recent. But people don't normally like period dramas because they're gay people in them. I'm aware of that.
Curious, I mean, you mentioned obviously there's a lot of sex in the series. Do you think it's going to surprise people who maybe come to period drama with a certain expectation of wholesomeness or a particular sanitized view of history?
Oh, I don't know. It might surprise people, but I think period drama is often quite raunchy, isn't it? It's
Why are events like this that celebrate and support independent storytelling so special and important?
I think obviously commercial cinema has a lot of support, you know, all the time, and its sort of focus is trying to make those bigger budget projects. So independent cinema is really important, just because it gives other artists and sort of newer creatives a chance to sort of break in. But I think it also gives an opportunity to tell different kinds of stories, and maybe to a sort of more niche audience or not as global an audience. So I think it's important in that respect too. It's all about storytelling, isn't it, at the end of the day? So on All Four at the moment, Catch 22, George Clooney's series is on, that he did as a limited series, and I was really fortunate to be in a few episodes of that. I was directed sort of by George, did episode 1 and 6, and also Ellen Kuras, who's an amazing DP turned director. She's just fantastic. So it was really amazing being part of that project. So yeah, it's been out on Hulu, it's been out on Channel 4 just recently, and it's on Catch Up at the moment, so yeah, check it out.
I mean, obviously, for so many years, it was deemed an unfilmable masterpiece. What do you think it is, as a storyteller, the qualities that George has that made him the right person to take on that challenge of bringing Hela to screen?
Well, Luke Davis, who wrote it, who wrote Lion, and David Michaud, I mean, both fantastic talents. So, yeah, it's been considered unfilmable for a long time, right? But I think we're at that time in history now with our TV and filmmaking where there's lots of ground being broken. So... it's a really tight script. It's a really timely piece, I think, because it's all about that kind of toxic masculinity and how heroism is built up to be a certain type of thing. And Yossarion is a character who really is really honest with the audience and says, yeah, I feel scared. So it's quite important to sort of see a TV show like that at a time like this, I think, yeah.
Can talk a little bit about working with George, because obviously, I mean, people are very familiar with him as an actor, but I think as a director, he's rapidly establishing himself as a very significant talent as well.
Oh, he's an incredible filmmaker. I think, you know, even, you know, for me, I loved Confessions of a Dangerous Mind when he made that. He's been a fine director for years. What was really exciting is to go onto a set with someone you admire so much and them not disappoint in any way. He was just so incredible, very charming, and really sort of concise with what he's after. So there's none of that sort of wasting time trying to work out what you're trying to do. George was just very assertive, very kind, and very collaborative. And I think for a director and actor of his caliber to still offer that for the likes of me, for example, I thought it was really, really powerful. So yeah, amazing.
In this day and age, there's a lot of pressure on filmmaking because people have to make money a lot of the time. So when you can get to the heart of amazing stories without all the kind of clutter and stuff and really focus on that, that's got to be celebrated, right? I was away filming a show called Noughts and Crosses, which is going to be on BBC One, which is coming out fairly soon. I'm not exactly sure when, but I'm really excited about that. It's the adaptation of the Mallory Blackman book, so it's going to be BBC One. And yeah, everyone's really excited. We'll see. So basically, in a nutshell, it's a world where black people are the ruling class and white people are massively kind of subjugated, you know, and oppressed. And it's set in modern, well, in a kind of dystopian modern-day London. And I mean, I read these books when I was younger, and a lot of my friends did, and it was incredibly important and touched people in a lot of ways because, well, first of all, in our, you know, it's an amazing opportunity for black actors, I think, and it really is sort of, it's the kind of TV that should be made. I'm very, very proud to be part of it, and I think hopefully it will ruffle some feathers, and it's going to be really exciting. And it's been ages since the books came out as well, and so I think it's about time that it, you know, I'm a fan of it, so I'm like so thrilled to be part of it. And Mallory Blackman is like an icon, you know. I think she's given a voice to a lot of people that didn't have a voice, and she should be celebrated and you know, and applauded. So it's basically about two families. A white family and a black family, and I play the older brother of in the white family, obviously, and I'm called Jude, and I'm a bit of a bad boy, quite troubled, and I don't want to give too much away, but I'm sort of gone a bit of a journey, and I'm responsible for a lot of the bad things that happen, so I'll leave it at that. Ultimately, like, I don't think there should be limits, or there should be a pressure for there to be like a kind of political message. I think there's a spectrum of what is entertaining, what's engaging, and I don't know what the rules are, and I don't think anyone should know the rules. I think it's like that's part of the beauty of it, you know, filmmaking and stuff.
Why are festivals like this that celebrate independent storytelling and creation so special and important, do you think?
Well, I think it adds a huge amount of variety to our screens. There's so much that people are doing now that I enjoy watching a huge range of stuff, and it's important that everyone gets acknowledged in all the different platforms and all different parts of the screen. So I have a big touring show, which I'm just about to announce the 2020 dates in the next couple of weeks. I'm going to be on screen with a brand new big TV show, which is coming up next month. I can't tell you too much about it, but it's something big coming out very, very soon. I'm very excited about it.
People are fortunate enough to get tickets for the live show. What can they expect from that experience?
I have something very, very special planned. Obviously, I can't tell anyone in advance what that's going to be. It's going to be a very special moment for everyone who comes to see the show. Hopefully something they'll remember for a long, long time. So obviously, I came from Britain's Got Talent, which is obviously features and gives people a platform. People who might never have originally got that platform to showcase their passions. So I always wanted to get onto that platform because I knew that would be a fast track to where I wanted to be. I always wanted to perform magic to the masses because magic puts smiles on people's faces. That's what it's all about. The bigger the audience, the bigger the impact.
Do you think that the profession of a magician has changed a lot given the advances in technology and the pressures that you now have, particularly in a live audience environment?
Absolutely. Magic changes every year. Every year, magicians are trying to build on what they've already created. And every time something new develops in the technology space, it gives us more of a chance to change things up. But magic's always developing. That's why it's such a magical art.
Is there one particular set piece, one particular performance that's really blown you away that gave you that wow factor?
Absolutely. So I'm a big fan of David Copperfield. I'm not sure if you remember, but many, many years ago, he did a performance, I believe it was in Wembley in the UK, and he levitated all around the stage. That's one piece of magic that I'll always remember. Incredible. If you haven't seen it, you've got to look it up on YouTube. It's amazing.
There's a lot of confusion with independent, low budget, professional, unprofessional. You know, it's a lot of terms that get bandied around, possibly by the less educated film aficionado. So for me, you know, I seek out independent theatre, independent film, and independent theatre as well. Usually because in my experience, I found there is a broad sense that there's a sliding scale between creativity and money. It tends to be the less money, the more creativity, or the more creativity, the less money. And as you go to the other end, as the money starts to start playing a part, the creativity can start to diminish. You try to find the sweet spot, always, where creativity and money meet. But given the choice of the two, I favour less money and more creativity, which puts me fairly in the independent guerrilla filmmaking field. So it's always nice to know that people are turning up for work for the passion of the project, not just because they were being paid. It's nice to have both, but if I had to take just one, I'd rather be with people who are turning up because they're passionate for the project, regardless of what the pay scale may be. So for me, it's an indicator of passion for a project. I try to be involved in the festival every year if I possibly can, either by being in a film that's lucky enough to be selected, and if not, just coming along, buying that season pass and coming to see other people's fantastic work. I think my first Raindance was probably 2012, when I actually came as an exercise in networking. I was a bad networker, and I thought, if I just go to a festival every night, I'm bound to get better. So that worked. And this year, Elliot offered me a chance to be in the trailer, which secretly I've been hoping would happen every year. That very first year when I saw the fantastic trailer they shot, and I, as an actor, I just thought that would be a cool thing to be in. So here we are, 2019 was my year. Get on that soapbox and be part of the trailer that everyone gets to see every day at Raindance. So very excited to be here. I've got a fantastic film that's on early release at the moment at one cinema in Hailsham called Adventure Boys, Boys with a Z. It's an absolutely fabulous and I'm not even biased. I'm in the film, but I would be saying this regardless. It's a fantastic throwback to a type of filmmaking that we don't really see much now, a really good old-fashioned family adventure. It smacks of The Goonies, Home Alone, with a little bit of Escape from Witch Mountain thrown in, if you do your research into that franchise. Well, a little bit Disney-esque in its kind of, you know, safeness. Anyone can watch it, from your 90-year-old grand to your 5-year-old niece. And it's just a good old rollicking adventure based around a couple of kids who stumble across a bungling diamond theft and have to get involved, save the day, save their dad. And their dad's a speedway rider, so it's just the coolest thing. So I want people to watch out for that, Adventure Boys. We're hoping for general release later on this year.
What is so special and important, you think, about independent storytelling in particular?
I think we're at a really interesting time, you know, in terms of the commercial work that's being put out there and the you know, the IP that we're seeing in cinemas, you know, being the same IP that a lot of us grew up on. I think it's important to keep important cultural IP going, like, you know, Ninja Turtles and all of this cool stuff that's been happening. It should be rehashed. However, original stories are always here and need to be told. You know, that social dynamics change, you know, and it's important to serve those changing social dynamics and, you know, cultural events and evolutions. They need to be digested, and one of the best ways to digest these cultural evolutions is through art. You know, the politicians, you know, speak in code, so it's very difficult to take from them. You know, if we're on a truth-seeking journey, then we can find, you know, we can explore these modern cultural phenomenons that are transient and temporary in literature. But you know, art is the penetrating blade, you know, that cuts through all. So that's why independent cinema is so important, and I love it so dearly. It's a wonderful education for me to be here, for me to be a part of it. I know I'm going to get to see some really interesting, inspiring stuff that's going to help me grow and help me learn. I'm going to get to meet some interesting and exciting directors, writers, actors, and producers and everything. So, you know, it's education, you know, on all sides.
You've got some fantastic projects lined up for the rest of the year and beyond. Can you tell us a little bit about some of the great stuff you've got coming out and what you're most excited about people getting to see?
I'm really excited about the kind of plethora of stuff that I've got going on. I've really been trying to curate my career as such that I can hit all different angles, and I can do the big studio stuff, and I can also you know, jump in and contribute to the interesting art house independent pieces. So, you know, I started the year with Alita and Beale Street, you know. They came out within like 2 weeks, and they kind of show that kind of essence of energy of what I'm trying to do and the bases I'm trying to cover. But, you know, we got Maleficent coming out, which is just, was amazing. And to share the stage as such with, you know, Chiwetel Ejiofor, Angelina Jolie and you know, some of the other amazing cast at different points was just the most amazing education and just great fun, you know, and to spar with the heavyweights, you know, it was a good thing to, I think when you spar with those people, you're either going to get knocked out and, you know, realize you're in the wrong weight division, or you're going to, you know, it's going to make you feel stronger and feel even more settled in that weight division. And I feel comfortable and I feel good there. And then we got Midway, which is such an important and interesting proposition in itself. You know, to work with Roland Emmerich is one thing, you know, the master of the epic. I grew up watching all of his movies. But to do such an intimate story, which is really about brotherhood and, you know, the bonds of men and the bonds of family, and something which I don't think demonizes the Japanese, and just shows that, you know, this was all just young men at war killing each other. You know, I think that makes it a really interesting proposition. And then I've got Naked Singularity coming, which is like a really cool independent project. So the first time director Chase Palmer and John Boyega, Bill Skarsgård, Olivia Cooke. And I just wrapped an amazing, crazy project in New Orleans called Mona Lisa and the Blood Moon, which is just crazy, like amazing art with Anna Lily Amnipour. And it's like, I'm so proud to have been part of to have contributed to such an interesting project. It's so unique, it's different from anything I've ever done. And the whole experience was just a profound, profound experience that, you know, enriched me so much as a human being, as a person, let alone as a creative. So I'm just having all these amazing experiences. And, you know, as I say, I curated it as such, and me and my team have gone about setting it out this way. But, you know, it's one thing to plan something and to aim for something, but then when it's been happening and we've been able to do all this interesting stuff, and it's been so emotionally and creatively rewarding, it just makes me just feel very calm and just feel like keep calm and carry on and keep making decisions with my gut, you know, rather than for monetary or whatever reasons. And this festival is a part of that, you know, to just keep following my heart and surrounding myself by interesting people that are probably cleverer than me. I loved Alita, I really did. I'll just say that for the record. I don't love every movie I've been in. I'm quite scathing and cynical about my own work, and I loved Alita. I loved it so much. I loved what Rosa did with it. I thought it was such a wonderful character, the way she went from being childlike, you know, she almost went from a toddler to a middle-aged woman in the whole movie. And I loved that. And then, you know, as well as people being there like Christoph Waltz and Mahershala Ali, you know, these are two of my favorite actors of the last decade. You know, so, you know, it was amazing to work on it. And then we're talking about Robert Rodriguez, who's like become, you know, like a mentor to me in many ways for my short film. He really helped mentor me through a lot of things and gave me a lot of advice. I was touching base with him while I was working on my short film, and you know, he was one of the first people I sent it to, and it was done. So again, it kind of showed me, educated me about the kind of way that I want to make people feel on my sets, you know, and the way Robert makes people feel. He has this inclusive environment which is so dynamic and so creative, and just again simple, just following his instinct and trying to enjoy it at the time. And and Alita was one of my favorite projects I've ever worked on. Austin, Texas is probably my favorite city in the US now, and I can't lie, I would love to do another one, man. I would really, not many emails would make me happier than if I got one saying, from Robert saying, yeah, we're going again, get ready to put your Teletubby suit back on, and we're going to go and have some fun again.
I think obviously, I mean, there's a real appetite from fans, particularly of the original books, to see that story continue. I'm curious, when you were doing your research and you looked at the arc that your character had, are there particular things from the books that you would love to get a chance to explore more if you got that chance to go again on screen?
100%, and that was one of the allures of Zapan as a character. You know, I can't remember if it's 5 or 8 forms and bodies that he has, you know, ranging from kind of spider-like ones to berserker bodies like what Alita's got and such. So there's so much different, there's so much evolution that the character has. You know, and he does serve an interesting purpose in the role of Alita's life, you know, and obviously everything is there to serve Alita as it should be. But it's a kind of he's a mouth-watering proposition as a character in terms of his possibilities, you know. But I'll be honest, I'm completely like philosophical about it, and if it's one and done, I'm cool. I'm nice with it. It was a wonderful opportunity, a wonderful experience. I gained friends for life. So I'm my usual philosophical self. If it happens, wonderful, and if it doesn't, wonderful.
Of all the great stuff you've done, Deadpool's one that has a special place in their hearts. Can you share, I think, perhaps your favourite memory when you look back at your time on set with Mr. Ryan Reynolds?
Oh, man. There's so many favourite moments. I mean, I think the scene that was in the trailer where he was strapped down and he says my name, Francis, and then I come in and he starts talking about Basil Fawlty and Posh Spice and all of this. Well, every time we would do it, he would do a different name. And it was hilarious in that regard because, you know, he must have only said each name once, and maybe we did 15 takes or whatever. And I would walk off and I'd have to just bite my hand and swallow my laugh. And then as soon as they'd say cut, everyone would just roll around laughing, and that was a fond memory. But I would actually say my main overriding positive memory of Ryan is just what a gentleman he was on set. Again, you know, in the same way that Robert Rodriguez shows me how I want people to feel on set and to make people feel on set, Ryan showed me how to lead a movie, truly, you know, to lead by example. You know, he's the Steven Gerrard of lead actors, maybe I could compare him to, although he might never heard of Steven Gerrard. But he is, he's polite, he's gracious, he's kind, and he leads by example, man. He gave me a lot of generosity of his energy and spirit as a less experienced actor, and I'm forever grateful for that, and it's very important to me every time I'm on set to look after the less experienced actors or the younger actors or whatnot, and just to sort of contribute positively to the set, you know, because not all actors do that. But I salute Ryan for doing that, and he taught me well.
You won a lot of praise for your very public decision and explanation of why you bowed out of the Hellboy project. And I'm curious if you can talk a little bit about how you feel about the reaction that decision and your open letter received.
You know, I made that decision and wrote that statement because it was my belief. And I didn't know how people would react to it. And I was willing, I was open to them not reacting well to it, you know. So to see the positivity, the wave of positivity that's come out in the aftermath is amazing. I think every decision should be made in that pure way, you know, even if you fall on your sword. It's how I try to make my decisions, but I've never known any. I really didn't expect it to be that positive for people and for people to see it that positive. It was a lot more of a small, straightforward decision for me. Before I'd made it. Afterwards, I realized the cultural implications of it, and I'm just proud of it. You know, if most movie sets I go on, like, someone will have a quiet word, and, you know, someone from different demographics and such. And, you know, I grew up in multicultural London. You know, my family is mixed heritage, and you know, it means a lot to me, and always has. So it's nice to contribute something positive. But I must say, I find it very uncomfortable being in the public realm and writing and releasing statements and such like that. So I'm glad it went well, and where possible, I'm going to stay off the soapbox. I'm not out here trying to be, you know, the social, you know, savior or anything like that. But if I need to say something, and if I can use what little power I have and what little voice I have, I'll use it. And in private, I already do that anyway, you know? So, if it's a positive for other people, it's a positive for me.